instance there. Because if you take then a Simile model, we're going to work with Simile models. Simile models are going to be the box and wire composition of subsystems, and each subsystem, which in the end can be an atomic block, will be something that is actually processing input signals and producing output signals. And some of those blocks will basically provide some direct functional description of what the system is doing. Some of these blocks will be additions or multiplications or gains or whatever it is. Some other blocks will be something more complicated, will be state machines. Okay, so let's go for a second about these blocks that are state machines, and let's go back and see what is a state machine system. Okay? And in order to do this, we need to go very quickly through the general concept of a finite state machine. State machines are systems. As systems, they are operating on a set of input signals and producing a set of output signals. The state machines that we are considering right now will operate on signals that are defined, that are set of events or set of values defined over the domain of the natural numbers. So what is important is not the time at which a given value is produced by the order of the signals. So all our input and output signals will be defined over the naturals and consist of a set of symbols. Okay. So, again, what is interesting is the position with which a given symbol appears in our signal. A reference to time for now is not explicit, not implied, we don't care about that. As the name says, critical to the definition of a state machine is the definition of a state. What is a state for a state machine system? It is whatever summarizes the impact that the past values in the input signals have on the behavior of the system. So, it was badly screwed up. So let's consider our first example of a state machine, which is a recognizer of a given code. Okay? Again, we have a system that has as an input a binary signal, values 0, 1, okay, bits that are coming in, and the system will react, producing an output according to this behavior description. Whenever the input signal has the sequence 0 as the current value, 1 as the previous value, and 0 as the previous to previous value, okay, so two steps before, then the output of this system will be true. In all the other cases, it will be false. Okay. This is a very simple description of a system behavior. As a system behavior, this is not memoryless. This system needs to have memory about the past history because the behavior depends on the value of the input one step before and two steps before. Okay? So this is not a memoryless system, so this is actually a state machine. Okay? And in this case, it is a finite state machine because the behavior depends on what? It depends on the value of the values that are one step before and two step before. So we only need two sets of values. And these values are defined over a discrete range. So the only possible values are 0 or 1. So here we get the composition. The behavior is affected by two previous values, and these previous values can only be 0 or 1. So all the possible combinations are 2 by 2, 4. And this is an example of the behavior. So if you get this input sequence 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, the output, corresponding output, will be not defined, then false, because it is 0, 0, 0, then false again, because it is 1, 0, 0, And it would be true because it would be 0, 1, 0. Okay. So, what is in a state machine? A state machine, it is defined by this tuple here. Start from the bottom. A tuple of five elements. What are these five elements? The sum of all the possible states. The range for the input signal that you can also see in another way as the input alphabet or the set of possible values that you can get as an input on each and every possible input signal. The set of all possible output values. And one initial state among all the possible states of the machine. And one function update. Now, this function update in turn is a function that is defined over the domain of all the possible states, so all the possible states and all the possible inputs, and will provide as a result one state and one set of outputs. Okay? So it is formally defined as a function on the domain states, Cartesian product over inputs, and will provide two outputs, which are the value of the outputs and the next state. For convenience, very often the update function is represented as two different functions. So given that the update function produces as a result the outputs and the state, you can think of this function as two different functions. One that is the state update or next state, and one that is the output update, or output. And the next state, based on the current state and the current set of input values, will give you the next state. The output update, based on the current state and the current set of inputs, will give you the set of outputs. Okay? So this is the definition of the so-called MIDI machines. We'll go back to this classification later. For all the machines in which the output does not depend on the inputs, it is only a function defined over the states, then these machines will be called more machines. Okay, it will be different. Okay, so this is the conceptual scheme. Again, hardware design, this is how you do it. And by the way, if you are given any model. So I don't remember if I told you the other day about the modeling environment Psychos, which was the open source clone of Simulink, which doesn't have state machines. Okay. Can you represent state machine behavior in Psychos even without a formal state machine modeling environment? Yes. You can do as long as you have a DBA. So now, the state is represented by a set of values after this barrier of delays. And the two output update and state update functions will be purely functional blocks. Given that the set of variable values that represent my state and the set of input values, the update function is defining a new set of values that define the new state that will be applied at the next step. This is why we have a one-step delay. Okay. And so for all of you that are familiar with sequential logic in hardware design, this is absolutely nothing. What else? We will see in some cases, and this will be useful next, when we define the composition of state machines, that it will also be useful to formally define what happens in a state machine when there is no input symbol. So we said what we're interested in is the sequence with which the input values will arrive. But this is not entirely true. In some cases, when we compose state machines, we may be in the condition when one of the state machines that is the subject of the composition has an input value and the other does not have anything. And we want to describe what is formally the result of the composite, the behavior of the composite. So how can you define formally the behavior of a state machine when there is no input? We need to fill this gap. And we fill this gap. This gap is typically filled by defining a special input value that is called absent, or even do nothing. And we also need to define this, the update function for this absent symbol. And this is very easily defined. The state does not change, and the output will be nothing. Nothing as an input, nothing as an output. Okay, this makes sense. Now, with this very simple trick, you can formally define the behavior of a state machine even when you have no input. And again, this will be useful in a number of things. Okay. We had this in a paper, and reviewers were kind of shocked that we needed this thing. But it's useful. This symbol is also called the stuttering symbol. Okay. And we will add the absent symbol to every time to the set of possible inputs and outputs. Okay, next. We will have actually two classes of state machines. One that is finite state machines, but it's also possible to think of systems that are representing by an infinite number of possible states. Okay? I'll give you a very simple example next, but it is absolutely conceivable, and by the way, most of the programs you write are actually written based on the assumption of an infinite state machine. But what we're interested in are in this case, systems that are defined by a finite number of states. Okay? And we are also restricting to the case of finite input and output alphabets or set of symbols. Okay, yet another example of a state machine after the code recognizer. It is a state machine that is computing the targeting bit in a stream of bits, even or odd parity. Okay? So what is the parity? The parity meaning is if you have it can be odd or even, I'm telling you the odd description. If you have an odd number of ones in a given sequence of bits, then the output of the parity will be one. If the number of ones is even, then the output will be zero. Okay? For those of you that haven't seen this yet, I believe almost nobody has seen this yet, but in case there is somebody that is wondering what the heck is this for, this is used for error detection in computations. And again, the parity computation system is a memory-based system or a system that has a state, because you need to know if the past sequence of values in the signal contains a number of ones that is even or odd. And this is all you need to know. Okay, because if up until now we got an even number of ones, if we get any additional one true, then the number of ones become odd. If it was odd before, then it becomes even. But in case we get as an input a zero, if previously we were even, we're still even. If previously we were odd, we're still odd. So there are only two states here that are needed, representing whether we got an even number of ones until now or not. And this is the state update, and this other part is the output update function. Okay? So you see a state machine update function can be described as a table. Okay? And indeed, in hardware design, this is, at least when I was a student, this is the way they taught me how to define the state machine behavior combinatorial systems. But there is another way for describing a state machine besides a table, and it is a typical graphical diagram or description that uses bubbles or circles and arcs. This is the most common one, and this is the one that we're going to use from this point on, and this is the one that, with some variations, is used by most of the tools that are around. Okay. In place of the bubbles, you may have rounded squares. As a matter of fact, in UML and Stateflow, you have rounded squares in place of the circles. But other than this, most of whatever we're going to show is going to stay the same. Okay. So in this case, He said the state machine is represented by a tuple with five elements. Set of states. Set of states are represented by the bubbles. One bubble for each state. Then we need to know what is the initial state. The initial state is represented by a special graphical notation that is going to indicate what is the initial state. In some cases, it is called as pseudo-init state. So we need an arrow that basically indicates what is the initial state. The set of all the possible input and output values, which are the other two components of the tuple, are in most cases defined not graphically but outside in some other environment. We will see examples of state flow. Okay. And the last part is the update function. Well, the update function we said consists of two parts. The state update needs to say for a given set of inputs and a given state what is the new state. So it will be represented by an arc. And the arc will be annotated with the set of inputs that from a given source state, the source of the arc, go into another destination state, or the result of the state update. Okay? So an arc between two states will be the graphical representation of the state update. But we also have the output update. The output update will be annotated into the same arc for the same possible initial state and set of input values. Okay? But actually, you will see that the update function will be represented by a set of arcs in general, not a single arc. Okay, so very first simple example. Let's try to write the description of a state machine that is indeed a sequence recognition that will provide us with an output that is true if the inputs at time, current time, previous time, and two values before are all one or true, and it will be false in all the other cases. Okay? I said before there are state machine is defined by five things: a set of possible states, initial state, input and output values. We already have them here, right? They are binary. So input and output, we already have them. We need to define how many states we need. What is the initial state? What is the update function? So how many states we need, this is usually the trickiest part when we need to design a state machine from scratch. So one possible way would be, again, to reason like this. What is the previous history of the input that we need to consider? It is previous step or previous value and two steps from now. Okay, so we need to go backwards two elements in the sequence. And each of these can be either true or false. So we only have four possible combinations. False, 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 true, true, false, true, true. Okay? So this is one possible way. And we could represent a state machine like this. By the way, I'm doing it for convenience. So let's label a state machine like this. Four possible states representing previous steps, true, true, false, false, true, false, false, true. Okay? We will see that this is redundant. Okay? We can do with a lower number of states. Because two of the states are actually equivalent. It could be lumped together. Okay? But for now. So let's see now what is the transition. Okay, well, this is pretty simple. If you get true, true, and you get a false, the false goes on the left, right? So now you're going to true, false. If you get a true,
you stay in true, true. False, false, if you get a false, you stay here. If you get a true, you're going to false, true. And so on and so forth. So here, with the true, you go here. And with the false, you're going to the true. And then, so the value of the first one is missing. So if you have a false, you go here. And if you have a true, you go here.
Okay. Good. What is produced as an output? The output update part. I did only the state update, right? What is the output update? I need to produce a 1 when I have true, true, true. Right? And in all the other cases, it's 0. I'm using 1 or 0 instead of true or false, but... And then let's write true or false. So let's stick with it.
So, there is only one case here in which I receive true, true, and then another true. This one here. So this one will produce a true, and all the others. Produce a false, right?
Okay, one last thing. What is the initial state?
The initial state here is a little bit tricky. What's the initial state if I haven't received anything until now? So, in reality, if you want formally to be correct, you should say that the state machine should be described again with an assumption about what was the past history or about its own initial state. So in a description like this, you can actually put your initial state wherever you want. And based on where you put the initial state, of course, the behavior will be different. Okay? So in most cases, you probably want to put the initial state here, but I'm saying that this is arbitrary.
Is really arbitrary. So this is a state machine description for the system. And it is correct. Okay. Now I'm going to give another state machine description for the same system.
Now, this new description will be based on another interpretation. Now, what we're focusing on is the actual sequence. We're interested in the sequence 1, 1, 1.
So our states will not represent all the combinations of all the possible values for the previous two steps, which again, for a system like this, makes sense. Imagine if the input is an integer. Crazy. Okay, really. So you got what is called an abstraction. We will go back to the concept of abstraction. Okay, we abstract the past values with another intuition. What we're interested in is what part of this sequence appeared on the input up to the given time. So we can have the full sequence detected, or a subset of sites 2, or a subset of sites 1, or no sequence at all then. And actually, we will see that we shouldn't even need this third one. Okay? So this time, we go the other way around. We use the indexes of the states to indicate the length of the subsequence that has been detected. When we begin, we assume that the length of the subsequence detected until now is 0. And this will also be our initial state. Then we'll have another state that says, oh, we already found one element of the subsequence. And we will have another element that says, now we receive two elements of the subsequence. And now we go from here. Let's define the update function. If we haven't received any parts of this input sequence until now, then we get true. Now if we receive true, true is the valid as the beginning of a sequence. Essentially, a subsequence of length 1. I should put here 2 instead of 1. Okay? So I'm going from state 0 to state I detected a sequence of length 1 with a 2. If it is false, still I haven't detected any part of the sequence yet. Right? If I get another true from here, oh gee, now my subsequence is long 2. Good. I'm going to state 2. If I get a false, oh, we go back to the beginning. We reset the length of the subsequence, right? Now the interesting part is here. We already got 2 truths. If we get the third true, we get this. Right? Because now we detected the third true, but this third true also counts as we got another subsequence of length 2. Right? If we get false, again we go back here. And now the outputs 0, 0, 1, 0, 0. 3 states instead of 1. But the two are the same behavior. They are equivalent. So in general, one problem is, how can I tell when two state machines are actually defining the same behavior? Is this interesting? Of course it is. What is the meaning when two state machines define the state behavior and one has 3 states and the other is 4? Okay? You will typically think that this is more convenient, and in most cases indeed it is. The less states you have, the better it is. Okay, so you'll find in the slides exactly what I did on paper, and you find exactly the same state machine description here, which is the solution to our problems. Okay. And of course, a little bit more. An example, there is a little bit more elaborated, but okay, so additional shortcuts or graphical notations. What happens if we have an arc for which no input symbol is on the label of the arc? That means that transition is unconditional or is taken for any possible input value. Except, of course, the stuttering symbol, which is special and for which we already defined it. If no output symbol is specified, then the output is the stuttering symbol. Then you can also label one transition as else for a given state. What is the meaning there? The meaning there is that transition applies to all the input symbols that do not appear in all the other transitions from the same state. When we don't have an else transition, we assume that there is a self loop. Okay? Otherwise, we will have an underspecified system. We don't know what happens for a given symbol if there is no transition specified. So to solve this, we assume that there is a self loop every time a symbol does not appear in any transition and there is no else transition for a given symbol. Another shortcut, if the inputs are defined or an even finite set, which is always the case for us, then we can use not A or not a set of symbols to indicate all the complementing set. Okay? So not A means all the symbols that are not A. Okay? So these are examples on how to define the same type of state machine with an else loop. I think it is straightforward. We don't need to say much more. Terminology, receptiveness. Under the rules that I've given until now, our state machines will always react to a symbol in some way. Okay? Either by stuttering or by staying within the same state in a self loop or by an explicit transition. We are going to start with state machines that are deterministic. A deterministic state machine is a state machine in which for every state, each and every input symbol is used as a label to one and only one outgoing output. Okay. This means that the state update and output update are functions. Okay. So for each possible input, they have only one output. Okay. The state transitions, if you get a sequence of inputs and you keep track of the states that your state machine is in at each point in time in the given input sequence, you will get what is called the state response. Okay. There are five finite machines or finite state machines like the one I described until now that don't have any output. Those are called finite automata. And I guess some of you know what they're used for, right? You use them thousands of times. Well, some of you at least. What are finite automata used for? An example of a finite automata. That one is an output. The coffee. Compilers. What are the two parts of a compiler? Yes. And then the front end is actually consisting of what? Never wrote a compiler, any of you? The parser and the semantic analyzer. Yes. And parsing is consists of the token parser, right? You ever use lex and yuck? Lex is doing the analysis of the tokens, and yuck is doing the analysis of program syntax. Token recognition is actually a finite automaton. It can be defined as a finite automaton. Okay. Regular expressions. I don't know if you're familiar with regular expression. Each and every regular expression can actually be demonstrated to be in a one-to-one correspondent with a given finite automaton. Okay. Anything you can define with a regular expression, you can also describe it as a finite automaton. All the tokens in a programming language, you define them with a regular expression, and you detect the finite automaton. So lex is actually a finite automaton. It's generating a finite automaton. Okay, so finite automata are used to recognize patterns expressed by regular expressions, and although there are no outputs, there are special states, which are the accepting states in a finite automaton. And this means that we detected one token of the language. Okay? So, okay, there may be an example. Yes. So if you have a language that needs to detect a token that is described by this expression, it may be B or AB or AAB or any fine or any possibly infinite length of sequences of A's followed by a B. That can be described by a regular expression A star B. Okay, for those of you that remember the typical textual syntax. And it is also defined by this finite automaton. Okay. So if we get a B, then we already detect the token. And of course, if the B is followed by any other token, then you get out of the detection. If you get an A, as long as you keep getting A's, you're waiting for a B. As soon as you get the first B, you accept it. Consider this language. Now we need to detect a token in which any number of A's is followed by the exact same number of B's. Can you write this using a regular expression? No, you can write as a regular expression this thing, which is a different thing. But this is something different. Okay? You can write as a regular expression any possibly infinite sequence of AB. Okay? But this is something different. And indeed, this is not defined by a regular expression and cannot be detected by any finite automata. You will need an infinite number of states here. Because you need to keep track of how many A's you receive, because then you need to remember to detect the same number of B's. But since the number of A's that can be in the initial part of the sequence is unbounded, so is the number of states. So other examples, parking meters. You've got a parking meter that works like this. You can have as an input a time tick, or adding 5 cents, or adding 25 cents, or absent. That is always there. And the parking meter may be safe or expired. And we also have the absent as an output as well. What is the behavior of the parking meter? The parking meter at the beginning is expired. If you add 5 cents, you buy 5 minutes of time. If you add 25 cents, you buy 25 minutes of time. You cannot buy more than 1 hour parking time. So you're bounded, upper bounded by 60 minutes. Every time you get a tick every minute, and if the amount of time that you bought expires, then the meter is going to say expire. This parking meter behavior can be defined by state machine. How many states you need? Well, the amount of minutes that you have charged. In reality, you will not define a parking meter like this, but this is the actual finite state machine. Okay? I will use this next when we talk about abstractions and refinements. So keep in mind this very simple example. Another interesting state machine that we will come back later, a binary delay. A binary delay has two states, 0 and 1, and the states are representing the value that I received in the previous step. Okay. So, if the value received in the previous step is 0, and I receive a 0, this means that, again, the next time the value is received in the previous step will be again 0. If I'm receiving a 1, I need to remember that the values that I received previously is a 1 and go to 1. And from 1, if you receive a 1, you stay 1. If you receive a 0, you go to 0. And you output the value that you received in the previous step. So if in the previous step you received a 1, you output 1. If in the previous step you received a 0, you output a 0. Why is this thing interesting? Well, for two reasons. One, the delay has a pretty simple, intuitive meaning. Okay? If I tell you, you have a sequence of bits and you apply a system that is a unit delay, you mean that the sequence is delayed by one step. Okay? So compensating for delays and other things, I have a pretty intuitive meaning. The other reason why this thing is important is that this state machine is a more type state machine. And we will go back to this because it will be interesting when we do the composition. Okay? Meaning that the output does not depend on the input, but only on the state. If you are in state 1, you're always going to output 1. If you are in state 0, you always output 0. So the output update function is a function only of the state. It's not a function of the input. Is a more type state machine. And again, I believe I don't need to go any further on this. Two units delay. If you try to write down on paper what is the state machine description of a system that applies to binary inputs, produces output binary values,
and it's actually representing a two-unit delay. This is the state machine description that we get. So this state index is actually the past two values that you received. Okay? So you're always going to output the value that you received two steps before, which is this one on the left. See, this one is always going to output 1, this one is always going to output 1, this is going to output 0, and so on. So if you receive 0, 0, you get another 0, you stay in 0, 0. If you get the 1, you put the 1 here on the right, and you take the two elements on the right. So now you go to 0, 1, which is the previous system. Okay, and so on and so forth. Now, when we would discuss about composition, you would expect that this thing comes out if you put two of those in a sequence. Right? You put two unit delays in a sequence, what you get is a two unit delay. Right? So if you compose this in a sequence with itself, you get this. Okay? This is the thing to remember right now. Good. So I already anticipated this. Delays are special for us because they are probably the first example we've seen here of Moore type machines. Machines for which the graphical representation is the one here on the right. The output update does not depend on me. Why is this important? Because there is no more a direct connection between the inputs and the outputs, but the only connection or dependency between the input and output production goes through a unit delay. Okay, so it means that at any point in time, the output does not depend directly on the input, which allows us to break the loops and to break the fixed point functional description of the loop behavior, which for us is a problem because a fixed point equation is not guaranteed to have a solution, is not guaranteed to be a function. Okay? And we don't like things that are not functions. So now we see that delays allow us to break loops to avoid this fixed point equation solution. Okay, state machine is state determined if each transition and output depends only on the current state and the current input. Other things, well, we already saw this, representation of a state machine may not be unique, and we kind of already said that the representation of a state machine may be in many different ways. Update tables are useful in many cases. But as soon as the set of possible input values and the set of possible states becomes larger, the table becomes impossible to manage. And the same for the state transition diagrams. So we are using this bubble and arc formalism. Now, in many cases, you will have systems. We actually define a state machine behavior for a very simple interface that is programming a burner, a boiler, basically. Okay, we're already easily beyond 100 states. Can you imagine already a system with 100 states defined like that with a diagram? It doesn't fit in a page. Okay? It becomes a mess. So at some point we will need something that is more powerful to describe state machines. Okay. For now we have the state transition diagrams, which look intuitive, look pretty nice. As long as we have detection of binary variables, binary values, a sequence detection, simple delays, it works well. In practice, your state machines will do things much more complicated. And you will see that this is not sufficient. But we will go to our hierarchical state machines next. But in order to understand what is the real meaning of a hierarchical state machine, you need to understand what is the meaning of composition. So, one step at a time. Non-deterministic state machines. They will look a lot like deterministic state machine, except that there will be one, more than one possible transition for a given input. Like here, in the one that you see in the slides, if you're in state B and you get a zero, well, you can either transition to state A and produce an output zero, or you can stay where you are in state B and produce a one. Okay? So this is, again, an example of a non-deterministic state machine. Non-deterministic state machine, you don't have anymore an update function, but you can still formally describe them using the update rule as a relation. So with the set of all the possible outputs and the set of all the possible output states. Okay. So let me see if there is. Yeah. So non-deterministic state machines are still defined with a tuple with five elements with the following difference, or better, differences. Updates is no more a function, but it is a relation. So we'll call it possible updates. For a given input and a given state, possible updates will provide us now with a set of possible pairs, max state and output. Okay? And also, initial states will not be a single state, but may be a subset of all the machine states. Okay? So you may have many possible different initial states. So this is a possible table notation that corresponds to the graphical notation of the non-deterministic state machine that we've seen before. Why non-determinism? Okay, this is good. This is just two lines here, but the meaning of these two lines goes far beyond what it seems. Okay? Now, you saw non-deterministic state machines, your first reaction may be, gee, this thing is weird. Why do I want such a thing? Well, let's go back for a second to what I said when we discussed requirements. And I'm pretty sure that you dismissed what I said. You put in a corner of your mind and you said, gee, yeah, okay, guys, this doesn't sound good. So when we talked about the requirements, we said every time you give the description for a behavior that is required from a controller, C. This controller applies typically to a physical system, to what control engineers will define as a plant. So our controller will, in general, receive data from sensors on the state of the board or the system they need to control. So this may be a car, and you're receiving information from the sensors that are placed on the car. This is, for example, an IBS. And you're producing outputs that are affecting the state of the world. You are producing a braking action that is affecting the car dynamics. Okay? And when you describe a system like this, you need to describe not only the controller part, but also the plant or the control system. So in principle, you will need to describe the car dynamic itself, or at least the abstraction of the car dynamics that is useful for analyzing the properties of the set, controller, and control system. Okay? Now, you can have state machines here as part of the controller description, but you may also have state machines here as part of the description of the control system. Examples: suppose that you need to perform an error detection and recovery on a stream of bits that you are receiving out of a communication link. The communication link is this thing. Okay, the communication link may mess up your bit sequence. You transmitted the one, but you actually received the zero. This is something that you describe very well using non-deterministic state machines. Right? Non-deterministic state machine means an input is a zero, and I can give you a one or a zero, right? So this is what is meant when you see this line modeling randomness. The things that we want to control have a behavior that up to some degree in our model, we may feel comfortable to describe as a random behavior. the random action of flipping a bit because of electromagnetic interference. We may not be interested in describing all the electromagnetic sources and the impacts and the couplings and the things. But we should be just interested in saying, you know what, once in a while, the channel messes it up, okay? And it's random. So modeling randomness may be at several points in the system, okay? So this is about placing non-deterministic state machines on the side of the control system. But why do you want on the side of the controller? Now, the controller is an electronic and software design that we are going to develop. Why would we want to design something that for which the behavior is not deterministic? We want to analyze the things that we design. We want to make sure that they behave exactly like we want them to. We typically don't want them to be non-deterministic, right? Well, there is a reason why we want. We may want non-determinism, and it is abstraction. Now, for this, let's go back to our, well, I know that it is not the best example in the world, but I think it fits nicely. Do you remember the parking meter that I gave you before? 61 states, one for each minute, right? Now, what if I gave you a parking meter description like this? My parking meter consists of two states. One that is called E and it is expired. And another that is called S and it's called safe. How is the state machine description for my abstracted? And I will say next that this abstraction has a formal abstracted parking. Okay, if you are an expired and you get a tick, you are expired and you say that you are expired. If you are an expired and you get coins, you need to be safe, right? Whether you get a 5 or a 25, you're going to save and you are going to save. If you are in safe and you get coins, same, I'm still in safe, right? Now the tricky part. We're almost done. What if you are in safe and you get a tick? You may stay safe, or you may expire. This is the best we can say, right?
What uses this thing?
This doesn't have 61 states. This has only two states. I'm calling this an abstraction of the real parking meter. Okay? And I will say next that this is abstraction in formal terms, but we still don't know what is the formal definition of abstractions. For now, we will skip. Although it's the same thing as for abstractions in object-oriented software design. Same. What if I wanted to prove a property that says, give me a guarantee that if I put money, then this will be safe? I know it's a very simple property, okay? But what if we wanted to at some point check this property and says, look, I want a system that needs to satisfy this property. If I put money, then it cannot be expired. That sounds right. You can already demonstrate that property there. Okay, on that very simple description. Now, let's go formal for a second. Abstractions are about behaviors. Okay, so now let's consider the two parking meters, the one with 61 states. We call the state machine description as S1. And then the one with two states. Okay. So we said a state, a system here is represented by all the possible pairs, input, outputs. Okay? So behaviors are sets of pairs, input, output. Possible input I1, in the corresponding output O1. Then I2, O2, and so on. As many as needed, right? This is what we will call as the behavior of S1, right? And then we will have the corresponding behavior of S2. Right? Now, formally, S2 is an abstraction of S1 if this relationship between behavior applies. If the behaviors of S1 can be demonstrated to be a subset of the behaviors of S2, then we will say that S2 is an abstraction of S1, or the other way around, S1 is a refinement of S2. Okay? I'm giving you this definition in advance. Okay? And indeed, the two parking meter examples that I gave you are in this, can be demonstrated to be in this relationship. Okay? So whatever behavior you can generate out of the 61 state parking meter descriptions, you can always generate with this simplest one. This is capable of generating all the behaviors, of, which is kind of tricky, right? You've got a thing that has a smaller number of states, and it is more powerful, means that can be generated all the behaviors of something that has many more states. That makes more sense. This is the power of non-determinism. Okay? Now, if this relationship between behaviors is true, what happens if you can demonstrate a property on all the behaviors of S2? It's clear, right? If a property can be demonstrated on all the behaviors of S2, since the behaviors of S1 are a subset, the same property applies also to S1. So now you get the chain. S2 is much simpler than S1. So if you manage to create an abstraction S2 that is much simpler than S1, and demonstrating that it is an abstraction can be simple in some cases. So it is simple to demonstrate that that is indeed an abstraction. Now you have a very simple representation, and it may be much easier to demonstrate a property on something that is much smaller. Okay? So now you created an abstraction, you demonstrated that it is an abstraction, you get a much simpler way to demonstrate a property. And now the property for free applies to the more complex system. You found the shortcut to demonstrating properties on the complex system. Okay? This is why abstraction and non-determinism may be also good on the controller side. Okay? Good. And we're really done. So another example, of course, I said, talked about bit flipping, but it is about coin tossing. Same example on the parking meter. This is the one you will find on the book. It's actually, you don't need three states, you can do it with two, of course. And this is about it. So let me close the video.